I'm delighted to be joined by Salman Shaikh, formerly the director of the Brookings Institute in Doha, now runs the Shaikh Group out of Paris, concerned with conflict resolution and creating positive political dialogue. So lots of talk about the new world order being a rather uncomfortable, imbalanced place. How is that impacting the subject of your interest, the Middle East? Does that make peace building more difficult or easier?
It makes the peacemaking more difficult because, of course, you've got no real roadmap as to how you are able to solve these conflicts. Instead, you have division. Of course, it's shown in the UN Security Council with regards to Syria, but I think it's much more broader than that. What you're seeing is an inability to deal with escalating situations on the ground. Remember, the Arab Spring was driven by the people themselves, but the international community didn't really have a response. And, of course, the number one leader in the international community, the United States, has been retrenching. It's been going backwards. And we hear that, of course, from President Trump, but I believe this was actually a trend that was started after the mistaken decision by President Bush to go into Iraq.
In terms of Syria specifically, you mentioned Trump. We're all still here kind of coming to terms with his announcements about military disengagement, in particular from northern Syria. I know that's a particular focus of your interest and your work behind the scenes with players and stakeholders. How does that announcement impact what's going on in that part of Syria?
Well, it's jumbled everything. Of course, foreign forces cannot stay in Syria indefinitely, whether they're invited by the Assad regime or not. But at the same time, there needs to be something which does not allow vacuums to develop, and something that leads to greater infighting and escalation. So there, if we don't get it right, we are going to see escalation. And we're going to see the bargaining that is going on between big powers cancel each other out, which is why we have to do two things. One, we have to listen to the Syrians themselves in the northeast of Syria. They know that they have to find ways of governing themselves, of arranging their security, and of delivering basic services to the people there so that you don't see the return of ISIS and other such non-state actors. At the same time, the international community needs to find a way to support that space and to help create the kind of stability which they want. They're not going to be able to do it if Russia, Turkey, and Iran are on one side, France, Germany, the United States, and Britain are on the other. So there is some talk even here about some sort of a 3+4 group or other such things. Of course, very much inspired by the 6+2 talks that led to the Iranian nuclear deal. Though, of course, the biggest hurdle here will be how do you bring Iran with the Americans?
What do you say to people in the region who listen to that kind of approach and say, well, hang on, this is a Syrian problem? For too long, this part of the world has been subject to the planning and the backroom dealing by big powers outside. We've been carved up enough already. Is that a legitimate complaint about that kind of approach?
It is. So let me point out, the Middle East broadly has been under, the Arab Middle East in particular, has been under probably 400 years of external direction and division. And so even in this, you see that Arab leaders are not actually able to get their act together. When was the last time the Arab League had an emergency session on Syria or on Libya or other such things? They look to the outside. But of course, the outside cannot do it by itself. It's proven from the mistakes and missteps that we have seen. They need to be informed by those who are actually involved in the conflict themselves. And 8 years into the Syrian conflict, Syrians have a lot of ideas. Syrians have been developing. They have a fledgling civil society, not least because of the support that they've got from countries like Turkey, but also European states as well. So I think it has to be two-layered. The inner circle, which is Syrians, producing these ideas, and then the outer circle, listening to them and finding those as a basis on which to come to agreements.
And just one more question on the specific role of Turkey in this part, in this new instability in northern Iraq. We know that Turkey's proposed a safe zone. We've known that the Russians have some reluctance to allow that to go. There's obviously a dialogue going on there. What is the most positive role Turkey can play to create the right conditions for peace in that part of Syria?
Well, history has shown that Turkey is an absolutely key linchpin in the international system, especially when it comes to the Middle East. Turkey being kept out, or Turkey being harmed, as we've seen First World War, other such episodes, is not going to work. Turkey can, in my view, play that bridging role between East and West, and not as a cliched vision, but a real one that will bring Russians and Americans and Europeans together, and the Iranians, to try and forge these kinds of solutions. Of course, Turkey cannot accept that its security is harmed, which is why it's put forward the idea of a safe zone to stop the PKK, which has manifested itself inside Syria, and other outside negative trends, to be held back. But there may well be, in my view, another way to do that, which is through creating a greater dialogue space for Syrians themselves.